Hi, I'm Mike, and welcome again to my film channel. And today I'm going to start a new series where I provide watch lists on certain subjects in film. And one of my favourite subjects for the longest time has been witchcraft and the occult, particularly in Britain, where we had a tradition of pagan religion for many, many years. Then the Romans came, and then slowly Christianity came, and the pagan religion was absorbed into Christianity, or it was made illegal, and the Catholic Church portrayed us, I was going to say us then, Freudian slip, they portrayed the pagans as, you know, devil worshippers and heretics and evil. And ever since then, that sort of race history of witchcraft in Britain has been used by artists, writers, filmmakers, as a kind of shorthand for the undercurrents in British society, the undercurrents of evil, the undercurrents of the old ways, you know, the wise women of the village, old in knowledge, and all this sort of thing. And I'm an absolute sucker for all that. And in the 60s and 70s, witchcraft came back to Britain. There was a revival in it. Wicca had been created, I think, in the 1940s. And witchcraft became big again in the Age of Aquarius. And suddenly everyone was interested in witchcraft, and witchcraft films and demonology films and occult films were everywhere. And I love that strain in British cinema, so that's what I'm going to introduce today. Now, there are three films, the Holy Trinity of British witchcraft films. The first is Night of the Eagle. Night of the Eagle. It's not that well-known a film, sadly. It was directed by Sidney Hayes, who's not a very well-known director. But it does star Patrick Wingard, who, of course, is a cult phenomenon in the UK. And he looks just as odd as he always does in this movie. Although he gives a very good performance. He plays a university professor who lectures on science and rationalism. But his wife is secretly a witch. And she's trying to protect him against bitterness and jealousy in his department, and there is a female professor who's got it in for Patrick Wingard. So many of these films are about female intellectuals. Witches were female intellectuals. Women were barred from education for many, many years in Europe. And in a way, the witch is a female intellectual. She's someone who has knowledge. She has knowledge of the old ways, you know, potions and herbs. It was a kind of metaphor for the female intellectual in a male-dominated society. And in this movie, a female intellectual, a professor, takes on a male professor, and his wife takes on witchcraft to help him out. That makes it sound a bit dry. Actually, it's great fun. At the end, he's tormented by this gigantic monster, which is supposed to be a stone eagle come to life, even though you can see the little bits of wire attached to its leg. And there's a great scene where he's in his lecture theatre and he's backing away from this terrible creature, and he's written the words "I do not believe" across the board, and as he backs away from the creature and he's squirming in horror, he rubs out the "do not" so it just says "I believe". Great stuff. So this is the entry for me into British witchcraft cinema. If you've never seen it before, it's great fun. The second film, this is much better known, is Witchfinder General, known as The Conqueror Worm in the US. If you're watching from the US, Night of the Eagle is known as Burn Witch Burn. But this is known as The Conqueror Worm in the US, Witchfinder General in the UK. And it's actually based on a real Witchfinder General, Matthew Hopkins, who operated during the time of Oliver Cromwell and killed many, many women and some men throughout East Anglia. Absolutely appalling abuse of power. And that's actually what this film is about. It's not so much about witchcraft. It's really about the abuse of power. It's actually a surprisingly serious film. It's got Vincent Price in it. It's got loads of women shrieking as they get burned and everything. But it's not an exploitation movie. It's not a fun, jolly romp. It's actually a very serious film about a dark period, the Civil War, in Britain's history, and what a lot of horrible people did during that time. And Vincent Price gives a very subdued, powerful performance. Famously, he and the director, Michael Reeves, didn't get on. And Vincent Price is alleged to have said, you know, "What are you doing telling me what to do? I've made so many horror movies." And Michael Reeves said, yeah, but I've made one good one. Fantastic bit of actor's gossip. But this film is a great film for showing the reality of witchcraft persecution in Britain. It's also a kind of English Western. It's one of the very few films that makes use of the English countryside. And the countryside, which was filmed in East Anglia, is so beautiful and haunting and eerie and lonely. And it's a kind of revenge Western, with Ian Ogilvy trying to take revenge on these, Vincent Price and his evil sidekick for their crimes throughout East Anglia. If you've never seen this movie, this is an absolutely essential British cult movie. Now, the third of these movies, everyone knows this one, don't they? The Wicker Man. If you've not seen this, you don't know anything about British horror. Come on. This is the British horror film. Now, what's interesting about The Wicker Man is it's actually not terribly well made. In terms of direction and editing, it's pretty straightforward. It's all in the script. Anthony Schaefer is really, I think, the major auteur here, not the director. And the script is so clever. It's clever on two fronts. First of all, it's the most pithy examination of the clash of religions you will ever see. Remember at the start of this I said that witchcraft was often paganism demonised by the Catholic Church. It was really a clash of two religions. This film picks up on that, and it pits Christianity against this new paganism that's arisen on this Scottish island. And it sends in this very Christian copper, played by Edward Woodward, to investigate the disappearance of this young girl in this openly pagan, openly, erotic and fertility cult society. And then at the end of the film, you realise that the film is not quite what it appears to be. And what you end up finding is the second thing that's so brilliant about this film and why I love it so much. The entire movie from beginning to end is a rite. It is a rite of a pagan religion. The whole form of the film, it's not just a straightforward narrative as it appears to be. It's actually an entire community getting together and practicing their religion together. It's one of the happiest of films. If you are a religious person, this isn't about a lot of horrible devil worshippers. It's actually a beautiful portrait of people coming together in their religion and in their faith and achieving something. Yes, okay, they sacrifice a man and some animals, but in their view, what they're doing is beautiful. And that's why this film still retains such a charge. It's a very strange, provocative film, very clever film about the way religions use other religions actually to push their own agendas. They need other religions to define themselves. That's what this movie is about. And that's why it's such a great movie. Yes, it's got Christopher Lee with a very silly haircut. Yes, it's got Edward Woodward trying to act. But it's really, really good. And I cannot recommend this film enough. So that's the trilogy. That's the big trilogy of occult, pagan, witchcraft films. But there are other films that you really should investigate. And key among them is Night of the Demon, known in the US as Curse of the Demon. This is probably pound for pound the best film ever made about the supernatural. It was directed by the great Jacques Tourneur, who made Cat People and I Walked with a Zombie with Val Lewton in the 1940s. In the 50s, he came to Britain to make this movie. This has got everything you want from a horror film. It starts with a picture of Stonehenge and some spooky music. It's got a guy who lives in a beautiful, stately home who's really a witch. A brilliant performance by an Irish actor who I'm going to just check his name because I've forgotten. And it is, hang on a second, Niall McGuinness, great Irish actor. It's got Dana Andrews, who's wonderful as the guy in the middle, like Patrick Wingard in Night of the Eagle, who doesn't believe, but he's forced to believe as time goes on. The set pieces are fantastic. They're very simple. They don't rely on big special effects. They just rely on suggestion. It's a fabulous movie, and it makes its point through the use of light and shadow, almost like a noir. It does have a big rubber monster in it. Tourneur didn't want this. This was imposed by the producers. I secretly like the rubber monster. It sort of adds a bit of Pulp Fiction fun to the movie. But if you've never seen this, this is one of the great horror films. It really is. It's one of the best exposés of that idea of what will it take for you to believe? And that's what the development of the film is all about. Now, at this point, horror fanatics will be saying, why aren't you discussing The Devil Rides Out? Why aren't you discussing Blood on Satan's Claw? Surely these are the two great British witch movies. I have to mention them because they're so famous. I don't really think either of these two films is that good. The Devil Rides Out is Dennis Wheatley, who was Mr. Witchcraft in the 60s and 70s in Britain. He wrote so many novels about it. He's now kind of forgotten, actually. I think, quite rightly, he wasn't that great a writer. The Devil Rides Out is a lot of fun. But I just, for some reason, it turns witchcraft into a bit of an adventure movie, like a caper movie almost. And I don't really care for that. I'm interested in the nitty-gritty of witchcraft as a religion. And so, for me, it's not really that interesting a movie. Blood on Satan's Claw, this is full-blooded stuff, and it's really a kind of picking up on the success of Witchfinder General. You know, it's got lots of sexploitation, you know, lots of blood and gore and horribleness happening in English villages. It's beautifully shot by, I'm just going to get his name, I think it's Dick Bush, actually. I thought he had a bit more of a exciting name than that. It is beautifully shot, and the shots of the English countryside are absolutely gorgeous. But I'm not sure that it's a great film. It's quite scary in places, I'll admit that. But I don't think it's a great movie. Now, while those two films are very celebrated, this one, which is actually called The Witches, let's see if you can see that better, The Witches, is not celebrated at all. This is one of the most neglected of Hammer horror films. I'm a huge fan of this film. It was written by Nigel Neal, so you can tell you're going to get a good script. He was Mr. Sci-Fi Fantasy in England since the 1950s, when he wrote Quatermass, right through to the early 1980s. And he writes a good script here, and he ticks off all the things you need to think about with witchcraft. So the idea of a religion that stayed in England all the way through, contra to Christianity, the idea of a community being brought together in a faith, the idea of the female intellectual, the witch defying male intellectual areas, you know. And it also has a very, very funny scene at the end where all the villagers get together in a dance, which is well worth watching. It stars Joan Fontaine, coming back from a career low, as a teacher who's assigned to this little village out in the Cotswolds or wherever, and finds there'd be no good happening there. And it's good, it's got cats, you know, that cross your path, people disappearing, deconsecrated churches being used as a place of worship. It's got everything you want from a witch movie. It's really good. It's well written. It may not be the most brilliantly directed film on earth, but it's well worth a watch if you've never seen it. Coming up to date now, a more modern film is Kill List. Now, to a certain extent, I've spoiled this film a bit by telling you that it's about witchcraft, because it starts out as a film about two hitmen in the Midlands killing various random people who don't seem to have any association with each other. But as it goes on, you realise that they are connected, and that they're connected as part of a secret society. I don't want to say any more about the movie, because part of the enjoyment of the movie is watching it unfold and seeing where it goes. This is a genuinely frightening and really, it really gets under your skin, this movie. It's brilliantly directed by Ben Wheatley, who I don't think has ever made anything quite as good since. I mean, A Field in England is also worth watching if you're interested in the occult and witchcraft. But this is really, I think, his masterpiece so far. It's a really horrible movie. Really, really gets to you. There's nothing nice in it. And those of us who've watched a lot of horror films over the years, there's something kind of great about that, you know. But I don't want to say anything more about it. And if you've not seen it, this movie is a movie about the experience, not about plot or narrative. It's not about what it says or even its themes. It's about the experience of watching it, which is so horrible and frightening. But I think this is a brilliant addition to British cult horror and British folk horror. Probably the best movie of that kind in the last 20 years, if you've never seen it. Now, those are movies, but if you're interested in witchcraft and folk horror, it's also worth looking at television. Because television has actually produced some of the best witchcraft movies ever. And I want to just talk about two. The first is Robin Redbreast. Now, this was a BBC play for today, made in 1970, so it comes with a few production failings. You know, it looks a bit cheap and tacky these days, a bit like film theatre. But I think it's filmed with a real sort of sense of mystery and eeriness. It's about a woman from the city moves to the village, and there'd be things there that ain't right. And Bernard Hepton, a wonderful British character actor, is the sort of really creepy elder of the village who tries to inveigle her into their cult. This movie came out before The Wicker Man. It's largely forgotten because it's a BBC TV play. It's really worth checking out. If you can find it, if you can find it on DVD, or you can find it on streaming, this is one of the key works of British witchcraft cinema, and I highly recommend it. It goes in a very unusual direction, very Wicker Man style direction, and it's worth checking out. You'll never ever put a seashell in your house ever again. And then, in the late 70s, on Yorkshire TV, there was this TV play, an hour long, again written by Nigel Neal, called Moraine. Now, moraine is an old-fashioned word for crop blight. Although it was also in the old days, the old people know this, it was applied to the person who created crop blight, i.e. a witch. And this is a really cheapo TV play made by Yorkshire Television. And it's set in this little village, near Derbyshire, I think. And the local farmers have got crop blight. And this guy comes to investigate it, and to his amazement and his horror, they're blaming a local woman for this, and they start to victimise her. And this guy from the city comes to her aid, but all is not as it seems. The only place I've been able to find this is on, this is a collection of a series made by Nigel Neal called Beasts, which in itself is quite interesting. And it's an extra on this DVD, if you can find it. And it's well worth checking out. It's really cheap, it's really lo-fi, but it's actually quite clever, and it gets a real sense of witchcraft happening in an English village in the modern day. A really matter-of-fact realism, which is quite interesting. But if you're bored of fictional witches, there's plenty of stuff you can watch about real witches. Best of the lot on this BFI Blu-ray is Legend of the Witches, directed by Malcolm Lee. This is great stuff. This is what you want. If you're into witchcraft, it's an hour and a half kind of pseudo-documentary about witchcraft. It goes through everything you need to know, from the religious foundations of it through to modern middle-class people trying out Wicca or witchcraft and, you know, jumping around naked in their living rooms in Kensington. I love all that kind of thing. And it's all there in lovely black and white. And there's some excellent extras and other different documentaries about the same phenomenon on this, so do watch this if you can. What they don't have on this DVD, and what I'm going to give a link to on in this YouTube video underneath, is Power of the Witch, which is my favourite witchcraft documentary, which was about 1971. It was an independent documentary. It is hilarious. It's like something from Monty Python. The guy who presents it, he takes it so seriously. And he interviews all these witches and all these people saying witchcraft's a terrible problem around here. And it's just hilarious. It is actually a genuine documentary, though it does come across as a skit. And I do advise you to watch it. It's great fun. But it's also an interesting insight to how witchcraft was a social phenomenon back in the early 1970s. Also, at the bottom, I've given you a link to an article I wrote about witchcraft for a film site called Zombie Hamster. And that goes into further detail about the subject. So I hope you've enjoyed this watch list. I'm going to do other watch lists in the future, but this weekend, get some witchcraft movies and get back into demonology and the occult. Thanks very much.